Thank you very much. Okay, so the first two lectures that I gave were pretty much stuff that's, you know, more than 100 years old, right? So it's very, very well established physics. And there were three parts. We were really interested in, what we're interested in understanding is the mechanics of interfaces, basically. And there were three parts to understanding the mechanics of interfaces in this continuum limit that I'm interested in. Number one is understanding the equilibria of the bulk phases, right? So for a fluid, that corresponded to having no gradients in the pressure. And then we discussed the equilibrium of the two-dimensional interfaces. And for the two-dimensional interfaces, we discussed the Young-Laplace law, which relates the pressure jump across the interface to the curvature of the interface and the tension that that interface bears. The tension is a force per unit length. So an important point is the Young-Laplace relationship, as I wrote it down there, only applies when phase one and phase two are fluids. It always works when the interface between the fluids is fluid. It can work in special cases when the interface between the fluids is solid, provided that the that solid-like interface has an isotropic state of tension, which is a rather special case. It works for a spherical balloon, and it works for a few other things, but it's not very universal. Actually, we'll discuss today some of the things that change. So if it's just the interface that has anisotropic elasticity, then it may just be the right-hand side that changes. I'll have to think about that. Today, I'll discuss what happens when the bulk phases have elasticity. And that changes the left-hand side of the equation. OK, so that was the first lecture, really, where we focused on the fluid interfaces. Then the second lecture, we talked about the equilibrium of where three phases come together. So it's the interface of two interfaces, or the interface of three interfaces, which is a line. One-dimensionally, we call that a contact line. And we considered the equilibrium of two types of contact lines. We considered a fluid droplet surrounded by another fluid sitting on a perfectly flat, perfectly rigid solid. Okay, so the solid was undeformable. And then by minimizing an energy, we got this expression, the famous Young-Dupré expression. And one really cool thing about this expression and about the empirical observations is that this angle theta, which describes how the liquid vapor interface hits the solid, is scale independent. So it's completely independent of any of the far field boundary conditions, provided that the system is in equilibrium. And therefore, it has to depend on the local physics. It's a type of singularity. And the physics governing that type of singularity are the material properties of the three interfaces. Okay. So the point is, this is a great guidance for an experimentalist that says, if you want to learn something about the material properties or the surface properties of liquids and rigid solids, measuring the contact angle is a great thing to measure. Okay. Okay. And then we considered the equilibrium of three fluids. So in bulk, we had three materials that were all fluid in the bulk and having a fluid interface. And in that case, we found basically that at the contact line, the force per unit length due to the surface tension, or due to the interfacial energy, because the surface tension and the interfacial energy are the same for a fluid, requires that those forces add up to zero as vectors, like you would expect for any proper force balance that balances things in all dimensions. Okay, and the consequence of that is that when the three liquid phases come together, or three fluid phases come together, that there isn't just one number that you need to characterize the singularity. You need two numbers. You need alpha and beta. Okay. So the fluid-fluid interfaces have 2 degrees of freedom. And if you want to understand the material properties of those three liquids, the surface properties of those three liquids, you need to measure both alpha and beta. Okay. So that's the summary of what we've discussed so far. So what we're going to do today is we're going to talk about what happens between these two extreme limits, okay? In one case, when we have wetting on a perfectly rigid solid, there's no deformation in the solid at all. But here we have wetting on a fluid substrate where deformation is free except for the interfacial penalty, okay? So what we're going to look at today and what we're going to start with and then we're going to move into some other stuff is what happens to wetting when the surface is deformable. How does everything work itself out? And then we'll branch into some other problems that are closely related. Leo.
So this is one equation for, let's say, 2 degrees of freedom.
Yeah.
So what can you imagine?
Just because it's a vector.
Right. No, but I'm saying, so you, what other information you put into? In the end, they want
Yeah, so this is sufficient, right? Because you just have, as I drew it in plane, these vectors have to add up in zero, up to add to zero in plane. So that's enough. This is sufficient, provided that you remember that we're adding them up as vector quantities. Yeah. Okay. All right. So today a big shift, and also a big shift in the way I'm going to present. Stuff today is I'm going to shift by working on the chalkboard, right, and talking about theory to showing you data. And I'm going to try not to tell you what I think is happening in the data too soon. I'm going to try to allow you to look at the data yourself and develop an opinion. Okay, so let's see if I can actually pull it off. Normally in a seminar, I only have 45 minutes. Right? So this is basically a seminar I would give. And I would have to, because I only have 45 minutes, I have to put the answer in at the beginning. So I'm trying to peel it back so we can go more slowly and you can think about it, give it, you have all the background you need to understand this. So I should first say that nearly all of the data that I'm showing you was taken by this guy, Rob Stile, who's now a lecturer in the maths department at Oxford. And there were lots of important contributions from various people in my laboratory and other laboratories. And so go Rob, okay? All right, so we're gonna look at Young Dupre, but we're also gonna look at two other what I would call foundational theories of interfacial mechanics. Okay? This one is how a liquid sits on a deformable substrate. This one, the theory of JK and R, Johnson, Kendall, and Roberts, is from the early 1970s. It is about understanding how solid surfaces stick to one another. And so we'll sort of try to take what we learned from liquids adhering to solids to understand how solids adhere to solids. And then we're going to consider another really important theory of mechanics, which normally is not thought of as an interfacial theory. But I'll show you how I think that it is. OK, so that's the big picture for the three topics I want to discuss today. We'll go quite a bit more slowly on this, because this is what I really prepared you for. And I really want you to look at the data. These I'll sort of like go a little bit more quickly. OK, so the first thing I want to show you is an empirical observation about what is the impact of deformability on the way liquid droplets sit on a solid surface, OK? So here's a very, very simple and quite convincing experiment here. So the basic idea is that on the left and on the right, we have a rigid glass cover slip. It's thick enough and stiff enough that for all intents and purposes, it doesn't move at all. And on top of that rigid glass cover slip, we put 50 microns of silicone, OK? So on the left and the right, they basically have the same surface energies, OK? The silicone against the air has the same surface energy. But the difference between the left and the right is the gel on the silicone on the left is going to be a gel with a modulus of 3 kilopascal, right, which is like Jell-O that you would eat. And the the silicone on the right is very intensely cross-linked, and it has an elastic modulus that's 1,000 times higher. Okay. To first order, it doesn't affect the surface energy. In general, one should not assume that it does. And you'll see in a moment that even if you think there might be a change in the surface energies, it won't be responsible for the weird stuff that's about to happen. I will say, though, that we actually did measure the contact angle of this liquid glycerol on both of these substrates, and we saw the same contact angle. So that's really the right answer from the beginning. But in principle, it could be different. Okay, so let's watch the movie. So what happens is we have a little sprayer of glycerol droplets, and we're going to spray glycerol droplets on the soft one and on the stiff one, and we're going to watch what happens over time. You can already see the first frame is at 290 seconds because it takes us some time to focus the microscope and everything. So you can already see after 290 seconds there's something different. Okay. So let's watch the movie. So both movies are playing. It doesn't really look like anything is happening on the right-hand side, right? Because nothing's happening on the right-hand side. So let's talk about what's not happening over here. Why it makes sense that nothing is happening here. So we have a bunch of droplets, glycerol droplets, sitting on a basically rigid surface, right? And apart from evaporating, there's really nothing that they can do, right? Perhaps they could coarsen through the vapor phase with Ostwald ripening if we had limited the volume, but basically there's nothing that can possibly happen. Okay. Here, when we spray droplets on this deformable surface, the key thing that you see is that the droplets can see each other from a very far distance, right? So the droplets are attracted to one another over large distances. So this is my favorite pair to watch. Bam. So there are long-range interactions between the droplets. So if you think about what are the possible long-range things, one thing could be that the droplets are talking to each other through the vapor phase, right? But that's true both here and here, right? So it's clear that the thing that has to be different is the elasticity, so that these things, the droplets must be talking to each other through deformation of the substrate, right? No, of their silicone on the top, right? There's squishy stuff on the top. The difference here is squishy top, rigid top. They're both supported by glass, but the droplets see the squishy stuff, or see the silicone in both cases. You know, I'm not exactly sure. I think that Rob actually took this with some of the polarizers in the microscope, but I'm not sure if they were quite crossed. I'm a little bit confused, actually, about why it looks like that. But I don't even know how he had set it up. The fact that it's dark makes me think that he did cross the polarizers. And I wonder if perhaps there's some liquid crystalline order in the substrate, or there's just something happening like with Brewster's angles or something on the surface. So I don't know. But yeah, so I would say it's cool, and but let's not get too distracted by that. If I have two water droplets next to each other, they can exchange fluid or exchange mass by evaporating and then recondensing. That's what I mean. It can cause one droplet to grow at the expense of the other droplet. It really wouldn't. I don't think of that. Yeah, I don't think that's the answer, right? Sorry, I was just being very pedantic, okay? Just to try to be open. I'm trying not to. In this, I normally run through stuff, and here in my data, I'm trying to try to give you a sense of when you're doing the experiments and you're thinking about all the things that might be going on, and you know, I'm spitting out hypotheses that turn out to not be correct, just for the sake of sort of dealing with the essential ambiguity of data, okay? Which eventually, hopefully, goes away. Okay, so here's another cool example. So what we have here is we have a rigid substrate. This time it's made out of plastic. Instead of glass, but the underlying substrate here is not flat. The underlying substrate is a bunch of cylinders that are lying down next to each other. So this is a picture of the substrate in cross-section. Okay, and then on top of that, we put the same squishy stuff that was doing interesting things before, and we make a perfectly flat layer of that squishy stuff. And the key thing is that at the top of the cylinders, the squishy layer is really, really thin. So if the droplet is deforming the substrate, and we think it is because that's how we think we're talking to each other, it's going to be harder to deform the substrate here because it feels the no-slip boundary condition underneath because it's so close than it will be to deform the substrate over here. Does that make sense? Right. So this seems like this will appear stiffer to the droplets, and this will appear softer to the droplets. So in the picture above, we're looking at this from the top, okay? And these dark lines basically are the cusps that tell you where the deep part is. And halfway between the dark lines is the thin section, okay? So let's spray glycerol droplets on top of these things and watch what happens. Okay. So here again, the droplets move like they did before. Okay. And here the droplets preferentially move from the thin slash stiff place to the thick slash deformable place. Okay. There are other sort of neat things that you see in this movie, some of which we understand, some of which we don't. The large droplets move a lot faster than the big droplets, right? You can also see long-range interactions between the droplets like we saw before. Well, what do you think? What's the scale bar? Yeah, so I think it's yeah, we can ignore gravity here because we're well below the capillary length, right? And also, even if we weren't below the capillary length, the surface is actually pretty flat, right? So we wouldn't expect, we're not biasing it gravitationally.
Can it be due to the basically gradient of the softness that you have and basically the upfront contact angle and the back part contact angle, they're going to be different?
Yeah, so I would say there's a part, that thing that you said that is an empirical observation, and that's the first part, and the second part is a hypothesis, right? First part is absolutely true. We made a gradient in the apparent stiffness, and the droplets are moving in a gradient from stiff to soft, okay? That's absolutely true. Okay, the second part of your statement is a difference between the contact angle in the front and the back, which I alluded to in my last lecture, that when droplets move, they tend to have that broken symmetry. And the data are also consistent with that. So if you look at the droplets as they move, the droplets are no longer perfectly circular here when you're looking at them from the top. That's equivalent to if you were looking at the side, you would see that they have different contact angles at the front and the back. So that's just playing back what you said, yeah. Fabulous question. Well, that is, thank you for motivating a lot of data that I'm about to show you. So that's a deep question. Okay, so here we go. So let's take it back and remind ourselves what I said earlier. Let's remember what we know about drops. Drops are different sizes. They all have the same contact angle, right? Because the contact angle tells you what's locally happening at the contact line. It only depends on the local physics. And then there's Young Dupre. Sorry, I'm just recycling slides from other places. I already said this today. So to sort of understand what's going on, let's see if we have local contact angle equilibrium. So let's measure the contact angle of these droplets and see if the contact angle depends on the stiffness, right? And let's also see if it depends on the droplet size. Okay? So here's some data where we measure the contact angle theta. On the squishy stuff where we saw the droplets moving, okay? And we do it for two different thicknesses of the squishy stuff, the 3-micron thickness of squishy stuff, which is sort of like the stiff part of the droplets that were moving, and then also on the 38-micron thick squishy stuff, which is like the more soft region. So let's look at the thick layer first. So you can see that for large droplets, the contact angle seems to be asymptotically or reaching some plateau. And if you take a droplet that's 10 times bigger and measure it on a different system, you get the same contact angle. So the contact angle is a little bit higher than 90 degrees in this system. And things sort of seem to be asymptotically approaching that. But as the droplets are smaller than about 100 microns, their contact angle changes. Okay, so what does that mean about this expression? It doesn't work, right? Because this doesn't have like any size dependent of the droplet. So it's depending on the far field boundary conditions, right? So this is hinting to us that theta, the traditional contact angle, is not the appropriate measure of the singularity. Okay, it's the wrong universality class. if you want to be really fancy about how you say things. At least for the small ones. For the big ones, it's the right answer. We can vary the size of the droplet by orders of magnitude. We did it by a factor of 10, and we see the same contact angle. Just when it gets small, that it seems to be part of a different universality class. Yeah?
So on a hard substrate,
yeah, absolutely. So down to very, very, very small length scales. And then there are, you know, conflicting reports about this breaking down. On theoretical grounds, one does expect, both from a thermodynamic standpoint and from a molecular scale physics standpoint, that ultimately this should break down for really small droplets, though I haven't seen a lot of really conclusive data. And it's the data is somewhat controversial. Yeah?
You said it, but I missed it. You're saying if you do it on a hard surface, then you can determine, well, from knowing these gammas, you know where the point is for the hard surface.
Yeah, exactly. So what the cool thing is, and I'm not showing you the data here, but I'm just going to tell you, there's two pieces of data I'm not showing you, that if I take a really, really big droplet, millimeter size, centimeter size, I get the same contact angle as I get, as you see here, greater than 100. It's just flat, totally size independent. And if I use a much, much stiffer substrate, it's perfect. I don't see any size dependence at all. Okay, and there's a hint to that here, because you can see that the contact angle not only depends on the size of the droplet, but it depends on the thickness of the soft layer. And the thickness is like of the squishy stuff is like a proxy for changing Young's modulus. And the reason why I prefer changing the thickness of the squishy stuff than changing the modulus itself is exactly for the reason that Sophia asked. It's because I'm nervous when you change the change the stiffness of an elastomer, you do it by changing the cross-linking. And who knows if you're changing the surface energy as well. So we change the thickness of the soft layer instead of changing the cross-linking. Thomas. Oh. Because I want to make it stiffer without messing with the surface energy. All right. Yeah.
Just one quick dumb question.
Yeah.
Why can't we consider these gammas to be changing with droplet size?
You can. At this point, I'm only showing you data, and that is an excellent hypothesis. Turns out to not be the right answer, but it's not consistent. It's not consistent with the data I'll show you later. Okay. It is consistent with these data, right? So. I haven't proven to you that you're wrong yet, but I will. All right. Any other comments? All right. Good. So, that doesn't work. Okay. So why? It's because we have the substrate is soft, and this liquid vapor interface is pulling up on the substrate, and there's a lot of deformation. So what are we looking at here? So this is a confocal microscope image of what's happening. We have our rigid glass slide. Okay. We have here 20 microns of the squishy stuff. And we have a layer of fluorescent beads on top, so we can see them on a confocal microscope. The beads are dilute enough that they don't affect the surface properties as we measure them macroscopically. They're actually much more dilute than they appear here, because this picture is an azimuthal collapse of three-dimensional data. Right? We projected everything onto R. So the yellow dots are actually much more dilute. So we have yellow dots on the surface, and we have white dots inside of the droplet. And what you can see is that this 50 micron droplet has a spherical cap, as we expect. But when it reaches the solid surface, it doesn't reach the solid surface with some nice normal Young Dupre contact angle. It's got this funky ridge going on. So it's strongly deforming the substrate. And so that's the thing that really jumps out to you, that there's deformation. But if you look closely, you can also see that there's deformation underneath the droplet, that the underneath the droplet's a little bit lower than far, far away from the droplet. Yes? Yeah, so that's because so we did two things. We have three-dimensional data. We collapsed everything as R, and then we plotted as R and minus R, so you wouldn't see just half a droplet. So that's why it looks like it's mirror symmetric. I mean, the image is mirror symmetric, but there's no mirror symmetry in the experiment. There's azimuthal symmetry in the experiment. Cornwall. I forget your name. Oh, ex- Excellent question. So that is such an important question, right? So I'm not going to show you the rheology data, but you can look in our papers. So at zero frequencies, at low frequency, this stuff is perfectly elastic in that there's no creep at long time scales. And this has a shear modulus that is finite as the frequency tends towards zero. Yeah. Ah, great question. Thank you. Yeah. So what I did in the other experiments, okay, I actually used an interferometer, and I didn't resolve what was happening here. All I saw was a spherical cap, some height above some surface that was flat. And then we inferred the contact angle by extrapolating. Excellent question. Thomas. Awesome. All right, so let's move on. So the droplets are deforming the substrate. So why is the substrate deforming, right? So the liquid vapor interface is applying some external force that's upwards to the substrate that goes around the periphery, right? So we have some out of plane stress. Here's the out of plane stress at the periphery. So we have some delta function r minus r of the liquid vapor surface tension that describes the force around the edge. And then we have some pressure inside, which is the Laplace pressure jump across this interface. So Young Laplace gives us the pressure inside. That pressure is pushing this down, right? And then this force around the periphery is pulling it up. Yeah?
We can think a little bit about the situation once you make the substrate soft.
Yes.
It's sort of like you're going to a limit of Neumann, where now you have three fluids, right?
Excellent hypothesis. I'm not saying anymore. Excellent hypothesis. So let's just forget what Leo just said. Let's try to figure out if we think, so we have some stress on the solid, right, that looks like this. This is a problematic stress, right? So if we think about what's happening here, it's problematic because the stress diverges at the contact line, right? You have some finite force over some vanishing area if you have a classical zero thickness contact line. And if you calculate the elastic deformation that you expect near the contact line, so this is some of the early data from Elizabeth Jerrison, both the displacement and the strain diverge at the contact line if you assume the response of the substrate is purely elastic. Okay. So and the key thing. So if you assume a classical interface which has zero thickness, it literally diverges. But you could say, okay, let's try to be a little bit fancier and say and have some stress cutoff that at the contact line the surface tension is distributed over some molecular length scale which corresponds to the thickness of the contact line. It has finite thickness. If you put in any reasonable guess for what the thickness of the contact line is, you still get completely unreasonable values for the strains that are orders of magnitude bigger than what we actually see in our experiments. In our experiments, we see strains that are of order one. If you put in sort of the size of a water molecule as the thickness of the contact line, you get strains that I can't remember. They're either 10 to the 3 or 10 to the 5 or 10 to the 6. But they're all way bigger than one. So that's why I don't remember which one it is. Okay, so you can't understand the deformation at the contact line just by elastic response of the substrate, and you can't fix it by introducing a molecular length scale, right? Yes.
How about if you
Do this
length scale
characterize this? Yeah. So that's really interesting. So the superficial answer to that is no, but the deep answer is sort of yes. Superficially, if we measure the flatness of the interface, it is flat. If we measure it with an interferometer, it's flat below the resolution of this interferometer that we're using that has sort of nanometer scale resolution. Okay. Then the question becomes, why is it flat? And why is it flat is part of the answer to what the fundamental physics is here. So, and we'll get there. It's flat as well as I can measure the flatness on the interferometer that I was using, which is at least sort of nanometer, tens of nanometers, maybe smaller. I don't remember. But as flat as we could measure on that instrument. Any other questions or comments? Do people understand the? Yeah, go ahead.
So the position of the y-axis is the position of
That should not say position. That should really say like displacement, right? That's really a displacement. The dots are data, and the dashed line is just what you would expect from an elastic theory with a delta function for a force of the contact line. So people understand the conceptual difficulty here that we want to address, and we're going to do it empirically. So all right. So what we're going to do is, we saw different contact angles, apparent contact angles for different size droplets. So let's look at how the deformation of the substrate changes with different size droplets. Okay, so here are the profiles for four different droplets, varying in radii from about 10 microns to about 225 microns. Okay. So this is the distance from the center of the droplet, and this is really the displacement in the vertical scale. One really important thing to note here is, look, that the vertical scale is tremendously stretched, right? So the strains are not as big as they appear to be. The strains are more like, the biggest strains are an order of unity, not 10, okay, or higher. So what do we see in all these pictures? So for the biggest droplets, the deformation field gets more and more symmetric around the contact line, right? And we have a peak, and then it sort of goes down and plateaus. There's a hint of maybe an undershoot, which we can talk about later. As you move to the left, the profiles become more and more asymmetric, right? And in particular, they get deeper and deeper and deeper on the inside of the droplet compared to the outside of the droplet. So those are how things are different. Yeah?
You mentioned the undershoot, but I guess for these ones that are further out towards the right, it seems like they go up pretty substantially towards the center of the droplet. Is that, if you continue to the line?
We just sort of ran out of field of view on the microscope. And it goes to zero. It goes up and then plateaus about here. Yeah. Good question. Sorry, the R equals zero is the center of the droplet. So to the left of the peak is the liquid, and to the right of the peak is the vapor. And there's some contact line, a liquid vapor interface that we're not seeing pointing up.
So for the red part, is R equals zero still the center?
R equals zero is still the center.
And it's not flat.
It's not flat at all. So it is actually continuous. It turns out that this shape is somewhat spherical. Because I've stretched the axis, it looks like it's exaggerating things, but it's the center is pretty much sort of parabolic or spherical. Yeah, exactly. The y-axis is stretched tremendously here. So you can always read off the droplet size by looking at the location of the peak, right? Because and that's about 20 microns. Okay, so we're going from about 20 microns to 10 times bigger, about 200 microns. Oh yeah. So why does it undershoot? The reason why it undershoots, it turns out, is that, and this is an interesting detail and it's a good pedagogical detail, that you only see the undershoot when we have a substrate that's thin compared to the size of the droplet. So that I'll tell you. I'm giving you the experimental observation. We only see this undershoot when the radius of the droplet is comparable to or bigger than the thickness of the substrate. So somebody tell me why there's an undershoot. Yeah. Exactly. So if you measure Poisson's ratio of this material, it's nearly 1/2, not precisely 1/2. So if you're pulling up a ton of stuff in the middle, you got to pull it down somewhere else to conserve mass. Okay. If it's an infinitely thick thing, then you can sort of distribute that over such a wide area, you don't get an undershoot. All right, so we talked about how all these shapes are different. How are they the same? Yeah, they all have peaks. They all have peaks, right? And we can shift or scale the axes to look at the peak. So let's do that. So let's just shift the peaks and align the peaks at the tip and ask, do they look the same? Okay. So if I take the biggest one and put it on top of the smallest one, and I just translate it, it doesn't work, right? But if I translate and rotate, bam. The biggest one and the smallest one look exactly the same. Okay, so Rob didn't do this for just four drops. He did it for 61 drops, and he varied the radius of the droplet from 20 microns to 1,000 microns, so that's real dynamic range. And he also varied the substrate thickness by about a factor of 3. And here what you see is he's taken all those profiles and he's shifted them and rotated them so that they're one on top of each other. And you can see that near the contact line, they all have exactly the same shape. But far away from the contact line, they're very, very, very different. And if we zoom in to the contact line, we see this nice these two straight lines that are coming into each other at an angle, right? Yeah.
When you choose how much to shift and rotate by, yeah. Is that based on some other measurement, or is it?
It's just completely on this. So basically, we just pick one of the shapes, and we basically fit two lines to it, and then we shift and rotate everything to line them all up. We minimize least squares, but yada yada yada. But we just pick some cone and then we go from there.
So if you could ostensibly measure the contact line,
yes. In fact, and I'll show you that. A great question. That's the next slide. Okay. Yeah. No, I think. Okay. Yeah.
I think of it as doing some sort of rescaling on the right and another rescaling on the left.
Well, it's not scaling any physical dimensions, it's just a rotation, right? We haven't
I want it to be some type of material.
But it is like a collapse, right? You have stuff that varies and then you collapse it, but we're doing an affine transformation. I shouldn't say that. We're just doing a shift in rotation, right? So I think people want to know, okay, go ahead. Yep. I don't know. It's the data. And the physical significance, I do know, right? But I want you to think like an experimentalist, right? I have a complex problem as an experimentalist. I see tons of crap all the time, right? But I want to learn something about how the universe works. So I don't look for what's different. I look for what's the same, right? And I found that all the droplets were looking very, very different, they have something in common. They have this little tent, and the angle is constant. That means, as an experimentalist, I interpret that there is physical significance to that. But we don't yet know. Well, I know, but you don't yet know. Maybe some of you have already guessed it, what the physical significance is. And if you have a strong hypothesis about what the physical significance is, just keep your mouth shut, OK? And be proud of yourself. Don't shout it out and ruin it for everybody else, OK?
Did you try to rescale by the radius?
We don't need to, right? If I rescale by the radius, it wouldn't look collapse anymore. Well, if it collapses when I don't rescale it by the radius, then if I scale by the radius, it won't collapse anymore.
You don't rotate, just rescale.
Oh, I guess you're right, because the angle, if I rescaled all dimensions by the radius, then this angle would be fixed. Yeah, that would be. That would do the same thing. I would be doing more manipulations of my data than necessary to get the collapse, so I don't want to do that. I want to do the least amount of my data to find stuff that's universal. OK, so now people are asking about how it rotates, right? So to collapse this theta, there's two things. There's how much I had to shift it and how much I had to rotate it. So let's look at how much I had to shift the data to get it to lie on top of each other. Oh, no, that's not what I'll show you that. OK, I'll do that, and I'll go back. So how much did we have to shift to get things to lie on top of one another? So this psi is how much we rotated compared to the biggest droplets, or the average of the biggest droplets. Okay, and so you can see as the droplets get smaller and smaller, this little triangle is rotating to the left. So negative psi means this thing is moving to the left. The really cool thing is if I superimpose what the liquid vapor interface is doing from my interferometry measurements, it's pretty much, but not perfectly, right on top of the data. Right. So what does that mean? About what does it mean that I'm rotating the solid cusp by the same amount that I'm rotating the liquid vapor interface?
Are
all coming together. So it means I didn't tell you actually. Yeah. Whoops. Let's go back now. So all three are moving them together. I screw up my segues here, but let's go back for a second and jump forward. I apologize for this. We have two straight lines. They have an angle between them. It's 93 degrees. Right? Independent of the size of the droplet and the substrate thickness. I can do the same thing on a different liquid, same substrate, different liquid, vary the sizes and the thickness, and I get a different angle, right? So it says that this angle is a material property, tells us about the material properties of the liquid, not the far field boundary conditions, right? So 93 and 149 are the two different angles for glycerol and fluorinert. And since we know the liquid-vapor interface, we know we can measure how much the liquid-vapor interface was pointing up initially and measure how much it turns over. We can also measure the angle between the air and the solid. And we find that that's fixed. Okay. So as you vary the size of the droplet, this whole all three interfaces rotate with one another but maintain a fixed angle. It does not. So you can actually here, I didn't point that out. But actually, so here, all the different colors are substrates of different thicknesses, so varying from 13.5 to 50. I think there are four different thicknesses that we used. And the far field, you can see they look very different. But in the near field, they don't care about the substrate thickness at all. Okay. Exactly. But depending on material properties, you get these two sets of angles. Okay? So what do you think's going on?
I think it reminds me of when you put your solid into the liquid.
Yes. Yeah, so it says that, yeah, so it reminds us a lot of this, right, over here, that when we put a liquid droplet on a liquid substrate, there was not one parameter that just was universal. There were two parameters that you needed, both of those angles, the angles between this interface and this interface, right, to determine what was going on. So and those angles are supposed to be independent of the far field boundary conditions and only depending on material properties. That's what we have here, right? So that strongly suggests a very good hypothesis, right? I would say, that these angles are determined by a balance of, I wanted to be really pedantic. I'll finish my sentence, and then I'll go through the data again. It strongly suggests that these angles are determined by a balance of the surface tensions, a force balance of the surface tensions at the contact line. Okay, so but I'm going to be hyper pedantic here and just summarize the empirical observations that I led us to that hypothesis. Number one is we saw that Young's law didn't work on squishy things when the droplet was small. I didn't point it out, but it's worth noting that the contact angle drops as the droplet gets smaller, so the substrate looks more hydrophilic if you don't think about it enough. Then the second point is that for droplets bigger than 100 microns, you actually regain a size-independent contact angle. And this contact angle matches that of the stiffer silicone. And then finally, within 2 microns of the contact line, all the interfaces are straight and meet each other at fixed orientations. And these orientations depend on the liquid. Okay. So the last hypothesis, the hypothesis that we just made together, right, describes this point, right? There's some balance of surface tension here. But we haven't resolved the first 2 points yet, right? So so here's our hypothesis, right, that what determines these angles are all these material properties. I have no idea what the next slide is. Oh, yeah. OK, so why? OK, good. Now I know what the next slide is. So I'm going to pose the question that I'm going to answer on the next series of slides before you all go to the bathroom. And you can think about it in the bathroom and come back in 3 minutes. OK, so this is a solid material, right? Generally, when you think of a deformation of a solid, you think about the balance of stresses with of externally applied stresses with the bulk deformation with the elasticity here. Here, I varied the elasticity by changing the thickness. Or you can just say, I get an answer that doesn't depend on Young's modulus, right? This is an answer that seems to only depend on the surface tensions. So the question I want you to think about and over the 3-minute break is, why can we forget about elasticity? So the data suggests that near the contact line, elasticity doesn't matter. Just like in Menon's presentation yesterday, elasticity magically disappeared, and surface tension was the only thing that mattered. Same thing is going on here. So take a break and think about that, and then we'll discuss it as a group. have this hypothesis that I think is strongly supported about the data, is that the local structure of the singularity doesn't depend on any of the far field boundary conditions, but our hypothesis about what governs the physics of the singularity only involves the surface tensions. It doesn't involve the elasticity. And I got a really good question just now in the break. It's like, well, you know, the singularities only depend on the local physics, right? But the elasticity is defined locally too. There's a Young's modulus here. So why on earth does Young's modulus not matter? It could, in principle, depend on Young's modulus, because Young's modulus is locally defined. But why does Young's modulus drop out of this problem? OK? So the way we do that is we think very simply, as physicists do, about a sort of thought experiment. And imagine that we take a surface that's initially perfectly flat, and we put a sinusoidal perturbation on the interface of amplitude A and wavelength lambda. And let's ask ourselves, what is the stress, the scale of the stress, that the solid is going to exert to try to flatten itself out? Okay? So as we know, the stress scale is the stress times Young's, the strain times Young's modulus. Okay? Here, the characteristic strain is the amplitude of the displacement over the wavelength, right? Strains are always some change in length over some distance. Here it's transverse, but we still have some displacement over a length scale. It's a you know, deformation gradient. So the elastic stresses should scale like the amplitude times the modulus divided by the wavelength. Okay, so that's what we expect for elastic stresses. As if you fix the amplitude and you take the limit as lambda gets small, the elastic stresses do diverge, right? So if you have a really, really sharp contact line, elastically, it's going to be expensive to make that really pointy point. Okay, so those elastic stresses can, in principle, get pretty big near the contact line. However, let's calculate the stress scale due to the surface tension of the substrate. Right, our hypothesis is that surface tension is governing things. So let's look at Young-Dupré. Young-Dupré tells us there should be a pressure drop across a pressure difference across this interface. Pressure is just another type, it's a specific manifestation of stress that's isotropic. That gives us a different stress scale. And Young-Dupré is the surface tension times the curvature here. And the curvature is the amplitude divided by the square of the wavelength, right? It's the second derivative. As we said many times, curvature is like the second derivative, right? So we get gamma over epsilon over lambda squared. And here, we're using epsilon because we don't yet know whether or not we can say it's the solid surface tension is the surface energy or not. Yeah?
Why is the strain either lambda and the gamma and lambda squared?
For which? Oh, the strain? Well, I'm looking at the average strain across this. And it seems to me like it would just be how far you're going up versus if I take the gradient, right? It's going from A to 0 over distance lambda. So the gradient of the out-of-plane displacement is like A over lambda. OK, we can chat some more over coffee. So let's compare the magnitude of these two forces, right? Or these two stresses. So the magnitude of the elastic restoring stress compared to the capillary or surface tension dominated restoring stress. And that comes out to be the wavelength of the perturbation divided by these two material parameters. Okay, so the cool thing here, there's a number of cool things. It says in the limit, as lambda goes to 0, elasticity is arbitrarily smaller than surface tension. Right? You can forget about elasticity for short wavelength perturbations, provided that the wavelength is short enough. And how do you know whether or not you have a small enough wavelength? It's this length scale. Okay. So what's cool here is normally in continuum mechanics problems, there is no characteristic length scale at all until you get to either except for the boundary conditions or the molecular scale. Here it says, and this came up a bit yesterday in Oleg's talk about the surface anchoring, you can get a length scale out when you have surface forces competing against bulk elasticity, right? So this is that we have here. We have a material length scale of the substrate, which is the ratio of its surface tension to Young's modulus. So the key point is if the wavelength of the perturbation is much bigger than this material length scale, then elasticity is going to govern how the material responds. Wavelength's much smaller than that, then surface tension is going to dominate. Okay, does that scaling argument make sense? Okay, so what's the most important thing we need to know to compare this to data? Exactly, we need to know what epsilon over E is. Okay, so let's consider it for sort of like three classes of materials. We're just going to pick some value of the surface tension, and measure, which is sort of similar to the materials we're looking at, and vary Young's modulus and ask what values we get for this, what we call the elastocapillary length. Okay, so for structural materials, right, the stuff that solid mechanics was invented for, this elastocapillary scale where you have to worry about surface tension is smaller than the radius of a hydrogen atom. Okay, so that means you have to worry about quantum mechanics before you worry about surface tension if you're worrying about the mechanics of structural materials, which means you don't have to worry about surface tension. Okay. Interestingly, though, when you start looking at like rubbers with megapascal scale stuff, this length scale becomes bigger than the size of molecules, but comparable to the range of intermolecular forces. Right. So there you sort of have to worry about intermolecular forces at the same time that you worry about sort of continuum surface tension. But for really squishy stuff, like the 3 kilopascal stuff I've been telling you about, this length scale is 10 microns, which is a perfectly continuum length scale, right? There is no interfacial physics or molecular physics that exists at 10 microns, right? So it says that this is a really important part, even if you're taking a continuum mechanics viewpoint of things. OK. Yes and no. Okay, so it's like a fluid in that the scale of the forces that it exerts to get itself back to flat is set by the surface tension. But it's not a fluid in that it doesn't yield or it doesn't flow. Right. So you can it says that you can basically strain is for free, but the strain rate is still zero. It's not a fluid. So yeah, so it's Owen has to be very careful. It's sort of like a fluid, but it isn't like a fluid. So, and the way to convince you that is if I put a droplet, I don't have this data here, but if you put the droplet on top of one of these substrates, let it sit there for 2 days and then suck it off, it goes back to flat. Right? It doesn't creep over time. It's really an elastic phenomenon. Just crazy, a reversible phenomenon. Okay, so how do we do this? So I showed you earlier Elizabeth's initial calculation where she said, you know, she showed how if you think of it purely elastically, you get this divergence strain. Then Elizabeth did the calculation in our original PRL in 2011 or 2012, showing that you can cut off the singularity with the surface tension, and Elizabeth and I made that argument I just gave you. Later, Rob came along and he solved it in cylindrical coordinates. And here I have, for an example, 4 data sets where the yellow points are data and the red line is a prediction. It's not a fit. It is a prediction where you just take linear elasticity and we measure Young's modulus by measuring the shear modulus in a rheometer and measuring Poisson's ratio, which is basically 1/2. And we measure the surface tensions by looking at the angles at the tip, right? And measure independently the surface tension of the liquid vapor interface, and we get those lines. Okay, so it works. Yeah. Well, the stresses don't diverge anymore because the surface tension gave it a solution that had finite strain. So the stresses actually don't diverge anymore at the contact line, which is pretty cool. And the other thing people often ask, these are really large deformations. It's amazing you can get away with calculating this with linear elasticity, right? And the reason for that is because when the deformations become big enough that you have to worry about linear elasticity, it's also in the same scale where surface tension swamps out the elasticity, so we don't even care about the elasticity anymore. So the idea is in the far field where the deformations are small, the characteristic wavelength of the perturbations is small, linear elasticity works great. As the strains get big, the curvatures also get big even faster, and they swamp out the nonlinear effects. So another really important thing here is to think about this, and this is how Degen originally thought about this problem. So when Degen thought about this problem, Degen and Martin Shanahan in the 80s or 90s realized that there was a problem at the contact line because there was a stress divergence. Okay, and what they did is they said, well, it's a singularity. let's just assume that the singularity is cut off by molecular scale physics, and then in the far field, assume that that singularity is characterized by some strength, right? And then you can calculate the deformation in the far field with some singularity strength, but you still get a divergence at the contact line. Here, so the point is that in the far field, the response is completely determined by elasticity. It's only in the near field, as you get near the singularity, that surface tension matters. But but what's different than what Degen was originally considering was this: it turns out that you don't need molecular scale physics to cut it off. The surface tension, the continuum scale surface tension, is sufficient to kill it. And also this. Yeah. You get the far field, but you get a divergent displacement at the contact line. So and you can measure a singularity strength in the far field, and you can report some molecular length scale, which doesn't really mean anything. It's really a macroscopic length scale. So yeah, the original singularity solution works fine in the far field. Okay, so this also tells you why we have different contact angles. So here again is our prediction. The dashed lines are the predictions for the dependence of the contact angle on the radius of the droplet and the thickness. It works well. It doesn't work perfectly. We didn't fit. We just did a prediction. And here, I think actually nonlinear elasticity is really important. So the key thing is, why does the contact angle drop when it gets smaller? The reason the contact angle drops when it gets smaller is because the Laplace pressure is starting getting really, really big, right? And as the droplets got smaller and smaller, there was a bigger and bigger dimple, right? So you have to have this big dimple, but you still have to have all the liquid interfaces meeting at the same angle. So in order to get the big dimple and to keep everything the same angle, the liquid vapor interface has to turn over, right? And that's what we capture here. Here, the deformations have a relatively low small wave number, right? And they're relatively large deformations. So I think one really needs to do linear elasticity to understand the macroscopic contact angle dependence. That's my hypothesis about why our data doesn't work. I mean, why the theory doesn't work on the data. OK, so that all works. So to summarize that, with wetting on deformable solids, there's two things. If the droplet's really, really, really small, the Neumann condition describes the equilibrium. If the droplet's really, really big, and Rob was able to show this theoretically, you get back, if you just take the limit of his equations to large droplets, you get back the Young-Dupré equation. However, if you zoom in microscopically, there's still deformation at the contact line. And that deformation at the contact line always satisfies the alpha and beta constraint. This alpha and beta is the same as this alpha and beta. Okay. So the real universal things are alpha and beta. They're completely size independent. Constant theta is an emergent property of large droplets on deformable substrates. Okay, or you could say it's an emergent property of droplets on stiff substrates. All right, how are we doing on time? Good, we have 25 minutes. Any questions? Because I want to move on to a different problem. Yeah?
When you derive the Young equation, you assume a flat surface.
Yes. But it still works. Yeah, it's really cool, actually. And it's just because, remember when we derived it, like it was really, the thing that was really governing things was the balance of how much liquid vapor interface you have on one side versus the other. And if the droplet is really, really big, the additional surface area you get by the cusp is small compared to the surface area you get by changing the contact angle significantly. Great question. Exactly. I mean, we do. So yeah, exactly. We do now. So on a deformable substrate, we know that locally, that on a deformable substrate, the vertical component of the surface tension is balanced by the surface tension of the solid. Okay. On rigid substrates, there's going to be a different story, right? On rigid substrates, this elastic capillary length is going to be comparable to molecular scale physics. It's going to be the singularity is going to have a different structure. And there's a few nice papers by Jaco Snoyer in the Netherlands and Anand Jagoda and Herbert Hui from the US talking about what happens in this limit where things get stiffer. So, and how you get back what happens on stiff substrates. And here are some references here. And those are, don't write them down because it's going to be all posted. All right, so let's go talk about another problem. Okay, so this is really what we focused. Everything was set up for this. I'm going to give you talk more briefly about two different problems. First, let's look at how rigid solid things stick to a deformable surface. So this problem is called the JKR problem. or the contact mechanics problem, rather, and the solution is by Johnson, Kendall, and Roberts. And the idea is that there's some adhesion energy between the rigid particle and the solid substrate. And the idea is that if this W is greater than zero, then you can lower the surface energy by making this contact zone that's in green. Okay, so this is the energy of the two interfaces before they come into contact. This is the energy of the one interface that come into contact. So when this is positive, if this then it ends up favoring adhesion. Or I think I have actually I have it. This is minus W. This is not W. This is minus W. This is minus W. So yeah, this is minus W. Sorry.
They're both solid, right?
Yeah. They're both solid. Oh, here one is perfectly rigid, one is gigapascal, one's something smaller pascal.
So the P shells the
here? Oh yeah, sorry. Thank you for asking. So sorry, I've changed notation a little bit here. P is for particle, okay. S is for substrate. V is for vapor. I'm sorry. And again, this is minus W, not W. So when the interfacial energy of the two interfaces is higher than the interfacial energy of one interface, they tend to stick to each other. I think that makes sense. And so what they did, so the point is if you have a rigid particle coming into a rigid surface, the area of contact is zero, so you actually don't gain anything. But if you can deform the solid substrate so you can make more contact area, then you can lower the surface energy. But of course, you do that at the penalty of deforming the bulk, so you have to pay an elastic penalty. And what JK and R did was to basically add these two together, right, and minimize the energy with respect to D to calculate how much it gets sucked in. Okay. So, but what they don't talk about, what they don't do, is they don't distinguish between the difference between surface energy and surface tension. And they also ignore the fact that you actually have to do work to bend this free interface, because you're making new surface area of the free interface as well. Okay, so we wanted to see if their theory worked on really squishy stuff. So here is some confocal data of a rigid glass, 15 micron rigid glass bead on a relatively stiff, compared to what I've showed you so far, silicone substrate. Here is the bead on a softer substrate. So we've sort of lined up the data from a lot of different beads. And here is the data on the same sort of very squishy substrates I've been telling you about. Okay, so measuring the contact angles, we know the surface energies are very similar in all these cases. So the surface energy that's driving adhesion is roughly the same in all cases. The difference is the stiffness. As you can see, as the penalty to bulk deformation drops, the bead gets sucked in more and more and more to minimize the surface energy. Okay. So that all, I think, makes sense intuitively. And it also qualitatively matches the theory of Johnson, Kendall, and Roberts. Let's test that. We'll test that quantitatively by measuring how far the bead goes in, the indentation, or D, as a function of the radius of the bead and as a function of the stiffness of the substrate. So all the red dots are 3 kilopascal. As a 3 kilopascal substrate with rigid beads going from like 5 microns to 30 microns. And then we do the same for stiffer substrates. And in all cases, the bead gets sucked in more as the bead gets bigger. And also, the bead is not sucked in, gets sucked in more and more as the substrate gets softer. Okay. So let's put in, this is the result from Johnson, Kendall, and Roberts. Okay. The key thing here is that predicts a dependence of the indentation, like the radius of the particle to the 1/3 power. That fits the stiff substrate data pretty well, right? And it fits all three of them with a similar value of the adhesion energy, which we expect because they have similar surfaces. However, it does not, with a free fit, it doesn't fit the 3 kilopascal data. Okay, yeah. Yes. One should check whether or not one needs to take it into account. And we did. And the indentation that you would expect from gravity is on a few nanometers, even in the really squishy case. Just because this is so small, right? It's just like for a droplet. remember the capillary length for a droplet was like a millimeter, right? We're 100 times smaller than that. The density is similar, surface energies are similar, so you sort of expect it to be in a scale where gravity is not important. And you can calculate it, it's not. Okay, so it's very different. So there's one nice thing about the JKR theory is that if you multiply all of the length scales by the stiffness, it's supposed to collapse the data. And even though our data doesn't match JKR, it actually, the collapse of multiplying it times all the length scales times the distance works. So if we take the bead radius times the Young's modulus and the indentation times Young's modulus, it looks like for all four of these stiffnesses, they all fall on the same master curve, okay, with the most interesting part missing. We have another paper we're putting on the archive next week that's going to have the stuff in between. It's on the same curve. Don't sweat it. So let's compare. But importantly, this universal curve for JKR is just supposed to be a power law of constant slope, right? This is a log-log plot. This should be a straight line, right? JKR only works for big beads or stiff substrates. For small beads or soft substrates, or small and soft, the scaling is actually quite different. It says that D is proportional to R. Okay. Yeah? The assumptions are linear elasticity and that the surface energy drives the adhesion, and that the only thing opposing adhesion is the bulk elasticity. Well, what do you think I'm going to say, right? Based on the first part of my talk today. So yeah, well, I'm going to hold that thought, and I'll say something else differently. So what does it mean if D is, geometrically, what's the implication if the indentation is proportional to the radius? What does that mean about how the solid interface hits the bead? It's always at the same latitude. Right? If D is proportional to R, it's always at the same latitude. What does that mean about this angle right here? It's constant, right? So it says there's a constant contact angle independent of the size, right? So looks like that. This is exactly what we expected yesterday when we put a rigid particle on a liquid substrate, right? So the implication here, right, is that for small particles, when we don't apply any external force, the indentation depth is actually given by the surface tensions. And surface tension is the only thing that matters. And it's just like a colloidal particle on a fluid interface. Okay, and that makes sense. Okay, why does it make sense? Because if the particle is small enough, the length scale of the perturbation can be smaller than the elastocapillary length, which means that surface energy penalties are way more than the elastic penalties. So the only thing you have to minimize is surface energy, which is exactly what we do for a rigid particle on a liquid surface. Okay, so that's pretty cool. We have a paper from that, you know, a couple years ago. And there's another paper about to appear really, really soon on the archive, which I don't want to give anything away yet. But it says that this is sort of right. Actually, it says that it's right, but not in the way, for the reason we thought originally. So, but I'm not going to say anything about that yet. Keep an eye out on the archive. OK, so I'm not going to talk about the theory except to say there. If you just add one extra term to the JKR theory, which actually Elie Raphael and Andre Dobinrin and someone else whose first name I don't know, named Carrillo, who hopefully isn't in the room. they did a very similar thing for deformable particles on a rigid surface. And they just added a surface tension term. And it works pretty well with our data. Looks really nicely with our data. And we can fit it. And also that simple theory, if you take the limit as d goes to 0, you actually regain analytically the Young-Dupré equation, which is really fun. You can derive Young-Dupré by adding a surface tension term to JKR. Okay, but I don't want to dwell on that. I just want to summarize. So for large particles where the elastocapillary length is much smaller than the size of the bead, JKR works great. Okay, but for small particles, surface tension completely dominates, and you forget about elasticity and Young-Dupré rules the day. Okay, so again, what we always see here, you know, what we've seen in two different, very seemingly very different experiments, surface tension is swamping elasticity when the curvature of the interface times the surface tension is much bigger than Young's modulus. Okay? All right. Questions about that one? All right, now I'm going to talk about a problem that appears to be completely different, but of course has the same answer. Okay? So we're going to talk about inclusions in solid materials. Okay? So the basic idea here is that we are going to put that what an inclusion is, you have some elastic material, and you put another material inside, and you apply some strain macroscopically, and you want to know how much this thing deforms. And if you know how that much that thing deforms, you can figure out if there are lots of those little inclusions what the macroscopic mechanical properties are going to be. That's sort of the idea of what people do with these things. Okay, so what we're going to do in this experiment is we're going to have some solid material, and we can stretch it, and that material is going to be silicone again. We can stretch it, and if we measure how much force it takes to stretch it, we can measure Young's modulus, right? Woohoo, you all know that. Okay? Now what we're going to do is we're going to put holes. We're going to replace solid material, which has a shear modulus, right, with holes, incompressible holes, because they're liquid, but they're still holes that have no Young's modulus or no shear modulus. And then we're going to stretch them and see what happens to the macroscopic material properties. Okay. So first, and the way we do that is we take silicone. And before it cross-links, we pour in some glycerol, and we mix it with a fork, just like you're making mayonnaise. But we don't put quite as much glycerol as you would oil or whatever. I forget how you make mayonnaise, but whatever. It doesn't matter. You go to relatively low volume fractions. Okay. So it's clear when there's no glycerol in it, but then we end up having lots of micron scale glycerol droplets, so it becomes cloudy as we increase the volume fraction. So we're going to make this material. We actually make it in a petri dish like this. And instead of stretching it, we poke it. But those are details that don't matter. And we measure the stiffness. So if we do that with with PDMS that has a modulus of 100 kilopascal, and we add more glycerol, so this is the volume fraction of the glycerol droplets, and we measure macroscopically how stiff the material is, the material gets less and less stiff, okay, as we have more and more liquid. And that makes perfect sense, right? If you replace a solid with liquid, it shouldn't be as good of a solid, right? And not only does it make perfect intuitive sense, it also makes quantitative agreement with the original theory of elastic inclusions by Eschelby. So this is this dashed line is Eschelby's prediction for putting in holes inside of a solid material with a Young's modulus that's equal to zero. So it works great, right? Awesome. Now let's do the same thing with 3 kilopascal PDMS. So drop the modulus by a factor of 30. And as you add glycerol, it doesn't get less stiff. It gets more stiff. Okay, so not only does the classic theory, which is all about elasticity, get the wrong answer, it gets the really wrong answer, right? It has the wrong sign, right? So it's completely, completely wrong. So so elastic theory works for the stiff stuff, but not for the soft stuff. I bet you know where I'm going to go with this, right? But before we go there, because I'm an experimentalist, I don't always assume that I'm right before before I see data, I get data. What I really want to do to understand what's going on here is I want to look at what's happening at the scale of individual droplets to try to understand what the governing physics is. So the experiment we do is we have a relatively stiff silicone sheet, which is stiff enough to support the squishy stuff, and transparent and thin enough that we can look on it in a microscope. And we have a relative much more dilute suspension of droplets than we had before. So we can really clearly take beautiful pictures of individual droplets. And then we apply some macroscopic strain to this solid material with droplets inside. And we measure how the droplets change. We observe and measure how the droplets change their shape. Okay, so at low strains, we start off with something that's nearly spherical. And as we stretch it, it becomes more and more elliptical, basically, more and more stretched, just as you would expect. So the key thing, let me just say, I quickly say a little bit more about the traditional elastic theory. In the elastic theory, there's no characteristic length scale because it's a continuum mechanics theory, and all the only boundary conditions are set by the other boundary conditions. All the length scales are set by the boundary conditions, right? So that says if I apply a certain strain macroscopically, the strain I get microscopically should be independent of the droplet size and independent of the stiffness of the material, provided that it's elastic. Okay, so let's look and see if that's true. Okay, so here I have three different droplets in the same substrate, and this is a squishy one of the substrates, and they're very different sizes. So the three different columns are three different size droplets, but we've expanded the images so they're about the same size on the screen, and different rows are different macroscopically applied strains. So this is strained just a little bit. They basically look the same. But if you look at the bottom and compare the deformation of the smallest droplets to the biggest droplets, you can see that the big droplets deform a lot more than the little ones. Okay? So this says that it can't be pure elasticity, right? Because it depends on the size of the droplet. If we've also repeated this experiment for a stiff substrate, and it depends on the stiffness. And for a stiff substrate, it doesn't depend on the size of the droplet, just like you would expect. We can plot up the scale dependence. So this is the drop aspect ratio as a function of the droplet size. And this is for 26% strain. You can see that for smallish droplets, less than about 15 microns, sounds familiar, 15 microns, the droplets resist deformation more and more. Right, but for large droplets, the deformation is plateauing to something. Yeah? That is the unstretched drop length. I'm 95% sure. I'd have to go back and read the paper. I'm pretty sure it's the unstretched drop length. So this is for one value of the strain. Same thing for a bunch of different strains, right? So this is a really big strain. These are relatively small strains. For all of them, you get some macroscopic plateau for the droplet deformation, which drops as the droplet gets really small, and it's really dramatic, right, for the largest strains. So one thing you might ask is, is this a nonlinear elastic phenomena? Because I have wonking big strains, right? These are huge strains. So what you can do is you can just divide out all these aspects. You can divide out the macroscopically applied strain from the aspect ratio. And if linear elasticity is good enough, they should all collapse. And they pretty much do, except for like the smallest droplets. And there we think it just might be the strains are too small for us to really measure. But the point here is that the ratio of the microscopic strain to the macroscopic strain is strain independent. So linear elasticity should pretty much do the job. And it says that for large droplets, it's independent of the droplet size. But for small droplets, it depends on the droplet size. What else do I say about this? Yeah, that's about it. So the droplets, the deformation depends on size. Oh, and here it depends on stiffness. I didn't know I actually had this slide. So here's the deformation as a function of size and strain for the floppy stuff. And here's the deformation versus size and strain for the stiff stuff. And you can see the stiff PDMS that showed the normal elastic behavior does not have any size dependence on the microscopic strain. So elastic theory says it should be independent of size and stiffness, but it depends on the size and stiffness. I think I beat that horse to a second death. OK. So what's missing from the classic theory? Surface tension. Yay. OK, good. So now we have to generalize the Young-Laplace equation, actually. So we normally have delta p equals surface tension times the curvature. But now the state of stress on one side, we have an isotropic state of stress, which is just pressure. But on the solid side, it's more complicated. So if you want to generalize that, you do a force balance, like we discussed a little bit in the discussion questions after the first lecture, instead of delta P, you get the difference in the normal stresses, basically, on either side has to be equal to the surface tension times the curvature. Okay, so this is a generalized version of Young-Laplace. It's just force balance on a little patch when you don't necessarily have a fluid on either side. One key thing here is that while we did allow this to have any generic state of stress on the left-hand side, we did, just for simplicity, assume that the surface stress is still isotropic, which it doesn't have to be for a solid. And we also assumed that it's strain independent, which it doesn't have to be for a solid. And it turns out that that's good enough, so we didn't do more than that. But one can and should explore those cases. So yeah, so the point is when if you say, OK, now I have some normal stress difference that's of this scale. I want to balance it against the stress in the bulk. I expect to get a strain of the scale, the curvature, times our favorite length scale that we've been talking about. And so that means when the curvature is really small, bulk elasticity should dominate. And when the curvature is really high, surface tension should dominate. I feel like I'm saying the same thing over and over again, right? So the key thing here is that surface tension dominates. And surface tension wants to make the droplet stay spherical, right? So the key thing is that the surface tension creates a new force that opposes the macroscopic, the deformation that's being opposed macroscopically. And so Escherby theory is not a mess. It's beautiful math, but it's difficult math. Thankfully, Escherby worked it out. And Rob, since he's an applied mathematician, was able to add in a surface tension term to Escherby theory and get it to agree with our data pretty well. In the interest of time, I'm not going to talk about these plots. I'm going to show you this plot, which I've already shown you. We have all the data here, and we have this dashed line. The dashed line is what we get by assuming linear elasticity and just adding surface tension to Escherby's theory. Okay, I'm going to skip to the end because we're out of time. So the key thing here is that when liquid inclusions are smaller than this length scale, surface tension dominates, elasticity doesn't matter. In this limit, fluid inclusions do the opposite of what you would expect. They stiffen the solid. They don't weaken it. And this is cool because Escherby is the foundation for all sorts of different theories in solid mechanics, for example, for fracture mechanics. So it'll be interesting to go back and look at how people have applied Escherby to other problems to see what happens when you include the surface tension term. And so we have two papers that came out this year about this, one that's all theory and one that's all experiment. So I want to end with the big picture here, okay, from today's discussion. So classic theories of interfacial solid mechanics don't work when the surface tension and the elasticity come together in this way that it's greater than one. Basically, for high curvatures, high surface tensions, or small values of the Young modulus, you have to rethink any theory that you want to use that involves an interface and mechanics. Okay. So qualitatively, these soft solid interfaces behave really, really differently. Droplets can move on a soft solid surface and they don't move on rigid ones. The contact condition for JKR is very different, and the volume fraction dependence of inclusions is the opposite of what you would expect. So these effects due to surface tension are not like, it's not like we're doing atomic physics and measuring things to the 18th decimal place, right? We're worrying about what the sign of the effect is, right? So there's really dramatic things that happen here. My lab is really interested in mechanics of cells and tissues, and there's a whole series of analogous problems that I don't have time to tell you about in the mechanics of cells. And I think that, there's lots of work for people to do over the next few years, thinking about all sorts of classic solid mechanics problems and seeing what happens when you turn up the surface tension. Okay? So that's it. Thank you. It fails when this condition is met. All of the classic theories for wetting, for adhesion, and for inclusions do not work in this limit, expressed in the most generic way: curvature, surface tension, and. Yeah, and that critical size is if I set the curvature to 2 over the droplet radius. So if you might have noticed that in all three of these, that's a great question. That's an excellent question. I didn't sort of beat that point to death as much as I beat other ones to death. The classic theories were all failing when the curvatures were on the scale of 10 microns, and if you plug in the numbers for surface tension over Young's modulus for the materials we're using, it's about 10 microns. So the yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Are you thinking about, like, so in the last fraction of time, you have a plastic cell?
Yes. I'm thinking about something a little bit more controversial. Okay, so the thing about all these old theories is they all have stress divergencies, right? And in some cases they were ignored, but the fracture mechanicians have done a good job of paying attention to the stress divergencies. And in metallic materials where there's plasticity and all that stuff, plasticity is what it cuts off the singularity, right? So my hypothesis is that in softer materials, there isn't a plastic zone. There, you cut off the singularity with surface tension instead of plasticity. That's my hypothesis. So it functions the same physical purpose of cutting off the stress singularity, but with a different mechanism. The length scale is very, very different. The plastic zone, I don't know how big a plastic zone is. You've exceeded my knowledge of fracture mechanics, so I don't know. I know what a craze is, but I don't know what drives crazing, what makes things crazy. Yeah.
I have two questions. One is, last part went a little too fast, I missed.
Yes.
So, you know, you replace the, in Young-Laplace equation, you replace P1, P2 by stresses.
Yes, exactly.
You know, one and two.
Yeah.
So is that the sense in which it's failing? I mean, I don't understand, so it's just kind of a
generalization. Yeah. So the, yeah, so there's two things. So no. Okay, so sorry. The problem, so the thing that I was saying was failing was trying to use Eshelby theory for a soft material. And the reason is for Eshelby, right, they ignore this term and they set this equal to zero. So there's no difference in normal stress across the interface. So they set gamma equal to zero. Yes.
When one of them is solid or something.
Yeah, exactly. So I guess if anything's failing, it would be the normal version of Young-Laplace is fail. If you tried to use Young-Laplace for a solid, you'd get the wrong answer. You have to worry about the fact that the state of stress in the solid is anisotropic. And then if you do force balance, you get this instead of that.
And the second question is, you sort of alluded to it, and I thought you were going to go there, but
sorry.
Droplets on the soft substrate.
Yes.
We studied.
Yes.
We saw they're interacting.
Yes.
Forming substrate. So you can think of the substrate, because the elastic medium is kind of mediating interaction.
Yes. Yes.
So has that been explored?
We've done just the slightest bit. We don't have much quantitative data on that. So one.
Are there projections?
I would say we have. We have some very sloppy predictions that I can tell you about over coffee that are not first principles, that are sort of like, we have a phenomenological model that captures some of what we're seeing, but we haven't thought hard about it. We've never thought hard about the theory, nor have we thought hard about the data there.
But
so,
sure.
And three cheers for Leo, who figured it out, right? Remember? We have figured it out. I told them to be quiet. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
So much.
Yes.
The stress of the tip of the crack is comparable to the fluctuation of stress.
Yeah.
As the second effect of the crack.
Yes. Yeah, that's interesting.
And then, they would eventually collapse.
Yes. Yes, exactly. Cool. Okay, any more questions? All right, let's get some coffee. Thank you.